Wild Pork and Watercress by Barry Crump, narrated by Martin Crump. Now a major film by Taika Waititi, Hunt for the Wilderpeople. Chapter 1. The Wife Sister's Boy. My proper name's Richard Morihue Baker, but they always call me Ricky. My mother was a Kotamari, and I was born in 1974, years later and a lot darker skin than my brother and sister. And don't let anyone tell you that doesn't make a difference. I always had trouble fitting in. People were always getting a surprise to find out I actually belonged in our family. I was also a bit overweight and not much good at sports and stuff like that. By the time I'd been at school for a few years, I could read miles better than most of the other kids, but I wasn't much good at anything else, and they decided I was a slow learner. They shifted me around from class to class, trying to work out where fat Maori boys who can't play rugby or learn simple stuff fitted in. I knew they had me all wrong, but there wasn't much I could do about it. I've always been able to remember just about anything I wanted to, and it's easy for me to learn things. Too easy. I was worried about all the stuff that was going into my head, and they were shoving more in all the time. The wrong sort of stuff, too. I couldn't forget a lot of it. I used to be scared my head was going to fill up till it couldn't take any more and I'd suddenly go mad or burst or something. So I took time off school, which I usually had to pay for with more trouble, but heads were only so big. Anyway, while all this was going on, my parents got divorced and my mother took custody of me, mainly because nobody seemed to know exactly where my father was living. He was never allowed in the house when he'd been drinking, and he just did more and more drinking till he couldn't come home at all. Things got worse at home and school until in the end my mother couldn't handle me. Looking back, I seem to have spent a lot more time standing in various offices while adults sat around deciding what was going to happen to me next. I soon found out that thin, white, difficult boys are easy to do something with than overweight, brown ones. When I was 9, they stuck me in a kind of health camp, but I couldn't stand it and got out of there as soon as I saw a chance. They caught up with me sneaking onto a bus to Wellington to stow away on a boat or a plane to Australia. I was carted off to a social welfare home for delinquent boys, which was worse than the health camp and trickier to get out of. I had to spend 3 nights there before I could get away, but I made it home and decided to hang on there as long as possible. The social welfare people found out I was there and came round a few times, but they left me there. By this time, my mother was getting ready to get married again. My stepfather-to-be liked it better when I wasn't around, but he did his best not to let on about it. My mother used to say that everything was going to be all right, and we pretended to get along like that. But less than a year later, I was back in social welfare home for shoplifting a bag of potato chips. They locked us up in that place, and I had a lot of trouble getting away. They found out I was back at home, but they left me alone. I think my new stepfather might have stuck up for me that time. He was still trying to like me, and I was getting better at keeping my head down. The next time they picked me up, I was riding a 10-speed bike I didn't even know was supposed to be stolen. I ended up in the same place as before, but they were watching me this time, and it was nearly a month before I got a chance to get away. I was on the loose for 7 weeks, joined up with a bunch of kids who were living in a burnt-out bus near Taupo. They didn't really want me around either. I was too inexperienced, they reckoned, and I might bring attention to them. We were living off what we could steal out of houses and cars and shops, so I don't suppose I could blame them, really. It didn't last long anyway. They busted in on us in the middle of the night and carted us all off to the police station. Then, after a long car ride in the early hours, to a prison place where they locked us up in cells. There was no way of getting out of there. Things were getting worse. This was actual prison. It turned out that I was too young to stay there, and after 4 days they got me in this office and told me I was being given one last chance to straighten myself up. I didn't deserve it, the social welfare men reckoned, but if I agreed to cooperate, my Uncle Hector and Auntie Bella Faulkner had offered to take me into fostership on a trial basis, and wasn't that wonderful of them? The bloke was lying. Uncle Heck would never have offered to take anyone like me in. He didn't even like kids. It was another shovel around without me being consulted about it. But being in jail's no joke either, So I said, all right, and the next day I was delivered to Uncle Heck and Auntie Bella's farm at the end of a windy, stony road, 87 kilometres from Gisborne. At this stage, I was 12 years and 3 weeks old. The Faulkner's farm was up a valley beside a river called the Opopo, and everything about the place was old and falling to bits. You could tell where their place started by all the thistles and scrub everywhere. Their road fence was all overgrown with briar bushes and long grass, and they had a rusty old drum on a post with their name on it near the front gate. Two muddy wheel tracks went curving up the hill to their rusty old blue car parked outside the house, which was surrounded by falling rails and a skimpy hedge, with weeds and long grass growing right up to the windowsills, round one side and out the back. On the other side was Auntie Bella's vegetable garden. There was a path trodden in the grass between the gate and the back porch. The Opopo River was about 100 metres from the house, and the old wool shed with its rusty corrugated iron and red-streaked mossy boards was out on the flat between. It was a skin shed, a tool shed, a workshop. It was the only other building on the place apart from the house, and everything happened down there. Uncle Heck used to spend a lot of time sitting on a staple box with a folded sack nailed onto it for padding, tipped back against the wall of the shed, looking up the valley. The river was quite a big one, stony and shingly and about 20 metres across at the crossings, with deep pools in between. Upstream, Uncle Heck's 140 acres went steeply up from the river flats, which were covered with clumps of blackberry and other scrub. Patches of grass were still quite numerous around the bottoms of the ridges, but higher up there was just manuka and gorse with streaks of new bush in the gullies. Beyond the dark ridges of native bush went right up to a broken blue range shaped like a train crash. It was real steep. From the shed you could see where little streams came falling down between the ridges to make Rough Creek, which ran into the Opopo up at the end of the property. It was an interesting place, all right. I'd been there a few times before this, visiting. Uncle Heck was usually taking it easy, and Auntie Bella was usually very busy. Auntie Bella was my mother's eldest sister, and it was she who had set up the taking me in to fostership thing. I could tell by the way she called me a poor lamb and was inclined to do a bit much of hair ruffling and cuddling and stuff. She was going to supervise me on the correspondent school. Auntie Bella's was the best place to be hungry I ever knew. I'll tell you more about that later. She always wore slacks and cardigans and had her grey-black hair in a big clip at the back to keep it out of her way. When Auntie Bella was angry, she'd call you a scallywag, whatever that was. It wasn't as serious as Uncle Heck's getting angry, that's for sure. Uncle Heck was very old, over 50. He called himself a bushman, but it was hard to tell exactly what that meant. Most of the family used to say he was a no-hoper when they talked about him at all. I'd picked up that he'd been in prison for something disgraceful when he was young. Another time I'd heard that it was for fighting. He was a grouchy old codger, and most of the kids were a bit scared of him. He was supposed to be a real stubborn when it came to an argument. He'd had a difference of opinion with the electricity people a few years before they cut the power off, so Uncle Heck told him to come and take their poles and wire off the place. There was a story about him getting a big fine for cutting down their poles with a chainsaw. He was tall and thin with bony knuckles and hairy blue eyes and only bottom teeth. That was really all I knew about Uncle Heck and Auntie Bella at the time I was dumped there, except that Uncle Heck had the most terrific way of shutting up my mother I ever saw. She never did approve of Uncle Heck, and just when he was getting wound up telling them what a lazy pig he was and how his sister deserved better, Uncle Heck would spit right past her. She'd never finished what she was saying, not once. You wouldn't have been surprised either if you'd seen Uncle Heck spit. They had a daughter, Cousin Judy. I'd only seen her a few times. She was a nurse, married to a doctor and living in Africa. She used to send letters describing the atrocious conditions where they lived. I was given Judy's old room next to the kitchen. Uncle Heck wasn't exactly overwhelmed with joy about me being there at first, so I wasn't exactly overwhelmed with joy about him either. As far as he was concerned, I was just the wife's sister's boy from the city and had to be put up with for the time being, till I ran away again or something. But at least Auntie Bella wanted me around. One of the best things about the Faulkner's place was all the animals. They had 11 chooks and a rooster called Dreyfus, who ran around free range and perched in the big macrocarpa at night. We were always looking around for where the chooks were laying this time. There were four Muscovy ducks half wild in the swamp across the river among the wild ducks and wekas and pukekos. There were
rabbits. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.